Please, Sarah.
So thank you very much for having me today. So today I'm going to discuss some results that are going to appear soon in collaboration with Lea Bottini. She was my master student here in Milan, Matteo Sacchi, and Chin Wang. So the theme of my talk is mirror symmetry. So mirror symmetry is a duality that relates pairs of three-dimensional and equal four theories. And the effects of this duality is to relate theories with the Higgs and the Coulomb branches swapped. It is known that this type of duality can be understood from string theory. So if we embed our n equal four theory, if we think our n equal four theories as a low energy theory on a Hanani-Witten systems of brains, so with D3 brains suspended between NS5 and D5 brains, we can understand mirror symmetry as an effect of S-duality. It has also been argued that the S-duality that acts on the brain setup can act locally on H5 brain. So in particular, an NS5 brain can be transformed into a D5 brain sandwiched between two S-duality walls to its right and to its left. And similarly, a D5 brain can be locally dualized into an NS5 brain with the insertion of an S-duality wall on its right and on its left. It is known that the effect of this S-wall on the D3 brains is to insert in field theory a TSUN quiver theory, which I will review momentarily. Now, the very simple question that I'm going to ask and try to answer in this talk is whether this local action of S-duality can be understood at the level of field theory. So can we forget about brains and strings and understand the local dualization just in field theory? So this dualization is basically in field theory suggesting that we should be able to convert a bifundamental, which is what we associate to an NS5 brain, to a fundamental and vice versa. So what I'm going to show you today is that it is indeed possible to define an algorithm to dualize piecewise a quiver into its mirror dual. And the algorithm is actually going to use the property of the S-duality wall and two basic duality moves, which are doing what is naively suggested by the transformation of NS5 into D5 brains. That is, these basic duality moves will gonna transform a fundamental into a bifundamental. What is also gonna be shown is that these basic duality moves are genuine infrared dualities that can be demonstrated in terms of other dualities. In particular, there will be cyber-like dualities. I must say that this type of question has been addressed in the past, but people focus on the matrix model that is obtained localizing n equal four theories on the tree sphere. And there were works by these groups where the local dualization was considered. And of course, there is an older result that for abelian theories, the local dualization was understood by generalized Fourier transform by Kapustin and Strassler. So let me introduce the main ingredients of this talk. So I mentioned the three-dimensional S-wall, which is the TSUN theory. It is a quiver theory with gauge nodes U1, U2, and so on. The global symmetry of this theory is made of a manifest part. There is a SUN X symmetry. You can imagine, so this is the manifest SUN X symmetry that it's rotating the Higgs branch moment map, which is basically the mesonic operator that you can assemble in a matrix transforming in the adjoint of the SUN X symmetry. So you take these mesons, these are your Higgs branch moment map. There is also another non-abelian factor in the global symmetry, which is SUNY. And this global symmetry is actually emerging in the infrared from the enhancement of the U1 topological symmetry at each node. And this symmetry is acting on the Coulomb branch. For example, we can assemble in a matrix C, the Coulomb branch moment maps, all the monopole operators that are the operators that carry the topological charge. You can construct a matrix that transforms in the adjoint of this other non-abelian global symmetry. There is also, if you want, you can consider another U1 symmetry coming from the anti-diagonal combination of the Cartan's UNC, UNH in the SU2H and SU2R symmetries. So this theory is known to have a mirror dual, which here I'm calling TSUN-CHECK, where the Higgs and Coulomb branch moment maps, which I indicate with a check, are mapped into the original Higgs branch is mapped into the dual Coulomb branch, and the original Coulomb branch is mapped into dual Higgs branch. So this is what mirror means. So it means that the theory in this case is self-dual, so it is mapped into itself, but there is a non-trivial map among operators, and in particular, there is an exchange of the Higgs and Coulomb branch. So the TSUN theory actually sits in a web of dualities. I discussed this arrow that connects TSUN and its mirror, and you see the map of operators. So H is mapping to C and C is mapping to H. But in addition to that, there is also another duality frame, which we call flip-flip TSUN. It's basically the same theory with an addition of two extra sets of singlets that are coupling linearly to the moment map operators. This theory, it's another duality frame. Across this frame, the operator, the H is just mapping to the singlets OH, and C is mapped in the singlets OC. So in this case, moving in the vertical direction, so moving from the original frame to the flip-flip frame, can be reduced to the sequential application of a more fundamental duality, that is Aronne duality and some of its variation. So moving in this direction, I'm basically moving across two dual frames, and this duality can be demonstrated in terms of other known dualities. What we are gonna see today is that also this line, this horizontal line that connects the mirror frames, can be understood in terms of a dualization algorithm that, in a sense, reduces mirror symmetry to other known dualities. So the TSUN theory.
Sorry, just a really dumb question, but what do you mean by a more fundamental duality? I mean, you said a more fundamental, you mentioned that a Aharoni duality is more fundamental. Like, what do you mean?
I mean, that I can demonstrate. Well, I mean that I can demonstrate a duality in terms of another duality that acts on a single node. So I iterate this, obviously it's a convention to say what I call basic, but for me, in the end, there will be just one duality that I need, and I will prove everything in terms of that one.
I see, okay, thank you.
I forgot to say, please interrupt me with questions anytime. Don't write in the chat because I won't notice it. Just happy to be interrupted. Okay, so the TSUN theory actually sits in the family of the Tiro Sigma theories. So apart from the notation that is not terribly important, this is the most general family of linear quivers. The nodes are UNs, the gauge nodes, and then there are flavors nodes, UMI. Now the quiver data, that is the ranks, they are all given in terms of the partitions, rho and sigma of n. So the partitions are specified by some sets of integers, and these integers here, there are some relations between the partition data and the ranks. So these theories, they have a part of global symmetry, which is manifest, that rotates these mesonic operators. And there is a part of symmetry that instead is emergent, and it rotates monopole operators that are grouped together for balanced node. So for this theory, mirror symmetry is basically swapping pairs of theories with partitions rho and sigma exchanged. So that's the most general type family of linear quivers with an equal force supersymmetries in three dimensions. Another thing that I want to mention about this theory, the theory of sigma theories, is that they, of course, can be realized on the brain set up by Anning-Witten with the D3 brain suspended between D5 and NS5, but they can also be defined as the theory that you reach starting from the TSUN theory at the end of an RG flow that is triggered by VEVs of the moment map operators, where the VEVs are again given by matrices that contains block Jordan matrices of size of sizes given by the partition data. So in theory, if you turn on this this deformation, you follow the RG flow, you can do this in principle entirely in field theory, you land on the theory of sigma theory. In practice, studying this RG flow, it's quite intricate, especially if you have to deal with a monoblock operator triggering, taking a VEV, so an Higgs mechanism for monopole operator taking a VEV. I mean, in fact, people usually resort to brain systems to understand what is the theory at low energy that corresponds to these VEVs. So last year we developed, in fact, an alternative strategy that allow us to work completely in field theory, to forget brains and to study the RG flow triggered by these VEVs. So I will not give you the details of this procedure, but it's important to mention that now there is this possibility, and this strategy is based on this web of duality that I have here. So one more thing that I wanted to say about three-dimensional theory is that mirror symmetry, now we understand that is also fitting this picture that I think we understood in the recent years, that basically all the three-dimensional n equal to dualities that we know can be obtained starting from four-dimensional n equal one cyber-like dualities and taking a series of RG flows. First you go down to from four to three dimensions, reducing on a circle, and then taking various mass deformations that can also, for example, generate Chersimons coupling. So the dualities involving Chersimons matter theories like Givion Kutazov, for example, they can all be derived starting from four-dimensional n equal one cyber-like dualities, reducing to three dimensions and doing various limits. And I think this was really understood after this series of works, where it became very nicely explained that if you compactify a four-dimensional theory on three dimensions, you first generate some monopole operator superpotential that has the effect of basically enforcing the same constraints that in four dimension were consequences of anomalies. And then once you understand the generation of this monopole superpotential, you can understand how to remove them with suitable limits. So last year we also understood that, I mean, mirror symmetry seemed to escape this pattern. It didn't seem, I mean, it was not known what how to start from a four-dimensional duality and obtain 3D mirror symmetry. But last year we constructed a family of four-dimensional theories that in three dimension reduce to the theory of sigma theories, and as their 3D daughters theory, they enjoy the mirror duality. So the starting point for this construction is a theory that we call USP2N, and is a theory that we started analyzing 2 years ago in a paper with these people. So that's the theory that is gonna be the main character of my talk, its variation. It's a theory in four, now we are in four dimension. It's a theory with n equal one supersymmetry. The nodes are symplectic, so it's USP2, USP4, USP2N minus two. These arcs now, they are anti-symmetric fields. And then there are bifundamentals between gauge nodes and bifundamental between gauge nodes and these SU2 flavor nodes. So this theory has, again, a part of a manifest global symmetry that rotates this mesonic operator, is this USP2NX part. And then there is another non-abelian factor in the global symmetry, USP2NY, which is also not manifest, but it's emergent. And it's emerging from the combination of all these SU2 symmetries that belong to this SO structure. So the first comment is that this theory can be really thought as the four-dimensional uplift of the TSUN theory that I discussed earlier on. In fact, there is a very well-defined limit that takes you from this theory in four dimensions to to this theory 3D n equal 4 TSUN. In the limit, you first compactify a mass circle, and then you break USP2N down to UN gauge groups, and then you give mass to one of the two abelian symmetry, the U1C, which is a symmetry under which the field in the SO are charged. So when you integrate, when you give a real mass for this global symmetry in three dimensions, this field in the SO are removed, and you go back to this quiver here. So this is where you end up at the end of this limit. And of course, when you go down, you also have an enhancement of supersymmetry. You go to n equal 4. So,
sorry to interrupt, but this UNT and this UNC, these are somehow related to the SU2R times SU2R symmetry.
This UNT is the anti-diagonal. It's precisely the n equal to star deformation of n equal of TSUN, precisely. This one is extra. And in fact, if I want to reach TSUN, I need to do a real mass for this one.
I see. And maybe another question. I mean, so this sort of uplifting of whatever 3D n equals 4 mirror symmetry to 4D sort of seems to require less supersymmetry in 4D. Is there some story that's sort of more explicitly 4D n equals 2-ish, or is it just impossible to find the
right?
You really need to be using n equals 1 4D language.
I mean, I don't know whether it's impossible to extend to more supersymmetry. At the moment, our construction is such that there is an equal one mirror symmetry in four dimensions with the sense to, there is also a version with n equal two in 3D. So in fact, if you take these theories and you reduce it to three dimensions, you get an n equal two theory, and it's exactly like this, okay? So, and it enjoys the same mirror-like duality. If you, then you need to do some real masses to go to the n equal four in three dimensions, but there is an intermediate step where you get families of 3D quivers which enjoy mirror-like theories. If you want a little bit more technical comment, is that you still have, you still don't have a Coulomb branch, because when you reduce this theory, you have these operators still are there, like these mesonic operators, because you still have to remove the SO. But in the reduction, you have generated monopole operator in the superpotential, so you don't have a Coulomb branch. So it's a mirror-like theory where you swap mesonic operator with mesonic operator. If you do a further limit where you remove all these operators, you remove the monopole operators from the superpotential, and then you restore the topological symmetry, and then it looks more like mirror.
Okay, I see. Yeah, I was just wondering more in the 4D n equals 2.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, at the moment it's just n equal 1. But
I see. Okay.
Yeah. Right. So this theory, as I say, it's just the 4D, if you want, version of TSUN. There are various interesting facts about this theory. For example, its superconformal index of this theory was actually studied independently by Eric Reins, the mathematicians, and this in this context, this the index of this theory is called interpolation kernel. And luckily for us, Reins has proven tons of very non-trivial integral identities for this theory, which for us, in a sense, they just correspond to non-trivial infrared dualities for this theory. And and this theory is also, we use in this paper to as a building block to construct E-string compactifications. But I'm not going to discuss this today. So starting from this theory, okay, so this theory is self-mirror. So it is it enjoys STSUN that was self-mirror. It enjoys a symmetry that swaps the two non-abelian symmetries that you can see. I mean, you can, similarly to the three-dimensional case, you can construct moment map operators. So you can construct operators that I'm calling with the same letter C and H, which transform under the non-abelian global symmetries. Here I'm calling H the mesonic operator that are acted by the manifest global symmetry. And there is another operator in the antisymmetric of the emergent global symmetry, which specifically you construct combining the fields in the soul to make mesonic operators. And the mirror symmetry, as I was saying, is also nicely, so the mirror symmetry at the level of operator is swapping these two, the operator charge under the two non-abelian symmetries that are swapped. And nicely, there is an identity for the indices due to Rhines that shows you that the index of this theory, it's invariant if you swap the Cartan's of the two non-abelian symmetry, and you also invert these T fugacities. And this is a very identical to what happens in the three-dimensional case, and the flip of the T fugacity in that case is interpreted to the fact that you are swapping U1C and U1T, so swapping the which are the subgroup of SU2H and SU2C, rotating the Higgs and Coulomb branch. Okay, so the USP2N theory, very similarly to the three-dimensional case, sits in a web of duality. So there is the mirror and there is the flip-flip dual frame. Also in this case, the flip-flip dual frame is obtained, you move from one frame to the other by iterating the intelligator Puglio duality, which plays the role of basic duality. So if you know this duality, I know how to go from the original frame to the dual frame. And so we will see today that thanks to this intelligator Puglio duality, in the end, we will be also able to prove the mirror symmetry that relates these two theories. Again, following this analogy that I'm trying to convince you about, the analogy between 4D and 3D, you can construct a family of theories that we call E rho sigma, which are the uplift of the T rho sigma theories. And the definition that we use is entirely field theoretic, so we don't have, and so we don't use, and we don't need brains for this construction. We define the theory E rho sigma as the theory that you reach at the end of an RG flow that is triggered by VEVs for the operator CNH of USP2N. The VEVs will be again labeled by the partition data. And thanks to the procedure that we develop based on the web, we can efficiently follow the RG flow triggered by this VEV and reach this E rho sigma theory. So I don't give you the detail on how we study this RG flow. I give you the final result. So that's the E rho sigma theory. So it's really the generalization, the 4D uplift of the T rho sigma theories. Also in this case, the ranks of the gauge nodes and of the flavor nodes are completely fixed by the partitions rho and sigma. So it's exactly analog to TSUN. The only difference is that now the groups are symplectic. So this is USP2N1, USP2N2, and so on. And in addition, we have this SO structure with the SU2 symmetries. And the mirror duality in this case is relating pairs of theory associated to rho and sigma partitions that are being swapped. Okay, so given this total analogy between 3D and 4D, the question that I can naturally ask also in four dimension is whether 4D mirror duality can be obtained by means of a local action of S-duality. And I will try to answer this question just in four dimensions, because I can go down to three dimension and equal four at any time, taking the limit to 3D plus just some real mass deformations. So In three dimensions, we identified the S wall with the TSUN theory. So I, by proceeding by analogy, I identified for the S wall with this theory that I introduced for you before. There is a slight difference in notation, it's called FE, but that's just because I have an excellent isometric. That's just a technicality for simplifying the gluing. And I'm now, from now on, I will just use this compact notation. So I have two boxes that indicate the emergent OSP2N global symmetry and the manifest OSP2N global symmetry. They are on the same footing, and I will be gauging indifferently both emergent and manifest global symmetries, realizing in this way Lagrangian and non-Lagrangian gluing. And I also keep T and C to remember the fugacities associated to the abelian part of the symmetry. So for me, this is going to be my S duality wall by assumption. And in fact, this assumption is also supported by the fact that this S wall satisfies gluing properties that for us are a motivation to call this gadget an S duality wall. So in particular, the first property that this wall satisfies is that if I glue two S walls, I get an identity wall. An identity wall, for me, is a theory that identifies the global symmetries of the remaining, the global surviving OSP2N symmetries. At the level of the index, these gluing properties is it's given by this identity where I gauge together two S walls integrating over Z. Z is the Cartan of the OSP2N global symmetry that I'm gauging. And the effect of this gauging is basically to produce a delta that identifies the Cartans of the surviving OSP2N symmetries. So this delta-like identity, if you take the three-dimensional limit of this identity, depending on how you take the limit in three dimensions, you can get either the relation S square equal to minus one or S to the minus one times S equal to one, which are the relations that you expect from an element for the S element of SL to Z. There is also a relation that relates S and T generators, which is also satisfied, but I'm not discussing this today. But we now have a proof of this gluing property. I think this gluing property were suspected. There were some evidences based on matrix model, but we now understand this in field theory. So now let me give you the field theoretic proof of this gluing property. So the proof has two main ingredients. The first ingredient is the iterative application of the interligator Puyo duality. This is a duality which for us is going to be really playing the central role. And the effect of this duality, the application of this duality is to split the theory that you obtain when you glue two S-walls in the product of many S2 theories with two flavors. And now the second fact is that the S2 theory with two flavors, it's a theory that has a quantum deformed moduli space and chiral symmetry breaking. In fact, you have that at the quantum level, you have that the Pfaffian that you construct with the mesons of this theory is non-zero. So it's classically zero, but at the quantum level is non-zero. And this means that if you think, for example, of gauging part of the SE4 global symmetry that rotates these two flavors, this VEV for the mesons are Higgsing what you were trying to gauge. And this fact at the level of the index is contained in the fact that the index of this theory is proportional to a delta Dirac distribution acting on test theories. And this is a very nice result that was proven by Spiridon and Vartanov. So now I'm gonna very, very quickly give you sketches of these two main ingredients. So let me say something about the SU2 theory with two flavors. So this theory can be reached starting from the SU2 theory with three flavors. So with three flavors, the SU2 theory, it's known to have a Desdomino dual. So it's in the so-called S-confining phase. And at the level of the superconformal index, you have that the index of the electric theory, which is an SU2 with these are the six chirals, it's equal to just a product of gamma functions. So these are elliptic gamma functions. And this product of all these factors is the product of the fields that live in the Vesumino dual. Starting from this duality between the theory with three flavors and the Vesumino, you can integrate out one flavor. So you turn on a quadratic term in the superpotential, a mass term, which is reflected in the fact that you have a constraint on the fugacities for these flavors. And this is implemented in a limit that you take on the index. Now, if you observe what happens when you take this limit and you focus on this product, you discover that some of these gamma functions are identical zeros. So you would conclude that the index of this theory is zero. Nevertheless, if you look at the remaining fugacities, some of these gamma functions develop poles at specific points of these remaining fugacities. So to understand what's going on at these points, you can take the index as a function of the remaining fugacity and integrate it against a test function close to the poles that appear. And basically the effect, the prescription to evaluate the index in presence of poles that are pinching the integration contour is to take some residues, which has the effect of evaluating in the end the test function at the singularities. So for generic test function, you conclude that indeed the index is proportional to delta functions. And these delta functions are supported precisely at the points where chiral symmetry breaking occurs. And so there is an identification of the global symmetries. So that's the first ingredient of the proof. And the second ingredient of the proof, as I said, is the iterative use of integrator Puglio duality. That's just a cartoon. And so here I'm considering gluing together two walls of length three, so n equal three. So this is the USP6 and the USP6 theory glued together. That's the compact notation, and that's the notation with the quiver where I'm gauging together these two S walls. So the strategy to go is basically to apply iteratively, which is what I'm doing in this cartoon. You see the node that is highlighted in orange is the node where I'm acting with the duality, which is the integrator Puglio duality, which relates USP to N theory, to NC with 2NF flavors, to a theory with USP 2NF minus 2NC minus 4 flavor. And that's the superpotential. It's basically a cyber duality for USP groups. So without discussing too much details, what happens is that as you move along this quiver with the integrator Puglio duality, at a certain point, so you reach a situation like at this point where you act with the duality on that node and that node confines, so that you split up the quiver into quivers of which are shorter. And then you continue until you completely split your original theory into products of SU2 theory with four flavors, which as we discussed, they are proportional to delta functions. So that's a very rough sketch of the proof, but that's how you demonstrate that the gluing of two S walls gives you an identity operator, which is basically a delta functions identifying the cartans of the surviving global symmetries. Questions? Okay, so basically with the same strategy, we can prove, okay, so I miss an ingredient. last ingredient that I need to introduce is the asymmetric wall. So so far I discussed walls connecting blocks of the same rank. I can also consider a block connecting USP2N and USP2N.
Sara,
yes.
You have 5 minutes.
Okay. Yeah. I will try to wrap it up. So I have this asymmetric block where I partially break the USP2N symmetry down to a smaller subgroup, and this is times an SU2. So that's the notation. So if I glue together a wall, an asymmetric wall, I still get an identity operator which identifies the USP2M symmetry to the USP2M symmetry times SU2. Okay, so with a similar strategy of iterating integrator Pouliot, we can prove two extra basic duality moves, which are the ones that I mentioned initially, that are the moves that are dualizing a bifundamental. So that's my bifundamental field, to which I attach also this part. So in four-dimensional bifundamental, for me, it's going to be a triangle. But if you do the sequence of limits that I discussed before, giving mass to this U1C symmetry, then you remove these fields and you just get in three dimension an ordinary bifundamental. But for the four-dimensional theory that I consider, that's a bifundamental. So this bifundamental is dualized into a fundamental, a USP2M fundamental, sandwiched between two S-walls. So that's the first duality move, remember. It's like an NS5 brain is dualized to a D5 brain, sandwiched between two S-walls. That's the field theoretic version. I have a bifundamental that is dualized into a fundamental, sandwiched between two S-walls. And then I have another basic move which dualizes a fundamental. So that's a fundamental for my USP2N symmetry. And I have actually 12 fundamental chirals. And I define this block together with an identity wall. So that is going to be dualized into a L bifundamental sandwich between two S-walls. Okay, so let me repeat. Bifundamental becomes a fundamental sandwich between two S-walls. A fundamental becomes L fundamentals sandwich between two S-walls. Now, these are actually genuine infrared dualities. So you take this duality here, you can study this duality mapping operator. So you can construct operator in this bifundamental symmetry, and you can reconstruct these operators working with the fields in this quiver. So it's a genuine infrared duality that's not just an identity. But in addition to that, I don't have time to prove this, but to show you this, but you can demonstrate these dualities iterating intelligator Pouliot duality, just like I did for the identity gluing of the delta. So basically, if you glue together two S-walls of length two with two flavors in between, that's the explicit gluing. If you iterate intelligator Pouliot, there are various things going on. This central flavor is moving toward the end of the quiver, which then sequentially confines to get just a Vestumino. So that's just a very simple duality relating this Vestumino model, which is for us the bifundamental block, to the gluing of two S-walls with two flavors in the middle. Okay, so now I have everything that I need. I can just state the dualization algorithm. The dualization algorithm works as follows. I give you a quiver and you are supposed to chop it by engaging gauge nodes, and you chop it into blocks which corresponds either to bifundamental or to fundamentals. Then you dualize each block using the basic duality moves, which I just discussed, which are the dualization of the bifundamental and of the fundamental. Then you glue back the blocks that you dualized, and when you do the gluing, then basically you produce identity walls and you arrive to a quiver that there are no S-walls left. But of course, the charges of all the fields are fixed in this procedure in a very specific way. And it might be that some operators have acquired a VEV. So you are supposed in the last step to follow the RG flow that is triggered by this VEV. And in this way, you reach the final theory, which is the mirror of the original theory. So that's the procedure, so which I illustrate here in a cartoon for a specific example. So that's my starting point. It's a simple quiver, OSP2 with OSP2 times OSP4 with 8 chirals. It's actually one of the elements of this Eero Sigma family. So in the step one, I chop the steering blocks. So I engage the gauge nodes and I chop it into 3 triangles and a fundamental blocks for 8 chirals. And then I use the basic moves to replace each block, which it's dual block. Then I am supposed to do the integration of the original gauge nodes, which are highlighted in orange. These are the gauging that I engaged originally to do the chopping. And now I restore this gauging. In this way, I produce 1, 2, and 3 identity wall that produce some identifications. So I arrive at this quiver. So you see all the S walls are gone. And I have highlighted in blue OSP4 times SU2 by fundamental, because the blue means that this guy comes with some charges that are that signal that this operator, that the mesonic operator here has a VEV. So I'm supposed also to study the RG flow triggered by this VEV, which in this case has the effect of breaking this OSP4 gauge group to OSP2. And then there is some other fields that are massive, but this is the final step of the algorithm. And this theory is actually the mirror dual of the original theory. So this is the algorithm correctly took me from one theory to its known mirror dual. And again, let me stress that this can be applied in three dimensional verbatim, just take the limit. Okay, so just time for conclusions. I gave you a dualization algorithm and all the tools that we use in this algorithm, that is the basic moves and the property of the S-wall, can all be derived using the intelligator Puyo duality. The algorithm, you may have noticed that I never mentioned unintuitive moves. If you are familiar with 3D mirror symmetry, you know that if you want to read out the three-dimensional low energy theory from a brain setup after applying its duality, you need to rearrange the brains with these Hanani-Witten moves to avoid certain forbidden configurations. To be honest, I was never, happy with those moves. They look a little bit like black magic. In this setup, you don't need to do any of those moves. Basically, they are taken into account by this flow that is triggered by the web that you naturally get after removing the S walls. And future applications that are going for sure to work are circular quivers, S-folds, and their four-dimensional analog. And we can, and we are also looking into more general S-duality transformation that can be studied with a similar approach with the introduction of the T-wall. Okay, I think I'm done. I don't know if I'm on time.
Sarah, thanks for the nice talk. Are there any questions? I don't see any hand up. If you want to if you want.
I can ask another question. Sorry. It's going to be another bad question maybe. But so I understood that this story involved a lot of 40 n equals 1 dualities, and you have some Lagrangians that exhibit some intricate IR dualities. And I'm just wondering, I mean, we also know in 4D that, well, there are lots of n equals 1 Lagrangians that flow to 40 n equals 2. So I'm still sort of fixated on 40 n equals 2. Yeah. Do any of the Lagrangians that appear here, do they have natural candidates maybe for 40 n equals 2 enhancement in the IR just in four dimensions?
I understand. I mean, we actually suspected that some of our theory would enhance, but I mean, so far I don't have examples of, in the theories that I discussed, I don't think they enhance, but there are.
I see. So you had suspicions from like computing central charges or something, or?
Yeah, also because since once you reduce them to 3D and do some flows, they enhance to 3D n equal 4. We thought that maybe you could see something also in 4D, but no, these are not enhancing. Although there are theories that you construct with these blocks that do have enhancements. I mean, theories that you obtain, gauging these blocks. Yeah, you can do stuff that is enhancing. Yeah.
I see, okay, thanks.
Okay. Sarah, I have a question, very silly, and forgive my ignorance. At the end, it seems that everything follows from all the moves from this integrator Pugliot duality. Is there a reason why?
I mean, to be honest, for me, it's really a big surprise. In fact, I don't know why it's like that, but I think it's, to me, it's extremely surprising because, in fact, I know of other types of dualities that I can prove in terms of integrator Pugliot. I'm not saying that I can prove everything in terms of that, but definitely my perspective is kind of changing that some of the dualities that look to be either of stringy origin or, you know, like they were, they seem to, in fact, descend from this most fundamental duality. So I think we can,
Does this duality have a string interpretation?
I think maybe you can do, for example, you can do compactifications of some 6D theories on Riemann surface and get two dual theories that are dual, you can see that they are dual to each other thanks to integrator Pugliot. I think there have been recent examples of construction from compactification when you realize, our own in three dimensions, but would that be really, would that make a difference in understanding that one duality follow from some 6D construction? I mean, maybe yes, maybe not. I mean, it's kind of there is a bottom-up story that seems to suggest that if you have 4D theories, 4D dualities, at least 2D dualities, it seems that most of them can be derived in terms of integrator Pugliot. And then there is all this other approach. You start from six dimension and you try to get dualities geometrically, understand dualities geometrically. I think I think we still need to understand how to put together these two approaches.
These two pieces. Mm. Okay. Are there other questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again. And we have a small break of 10 minutes, and then we start with the second speaker.
Thank you.
Okay.